This is VLX number 25, Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 to 20, the Sermon on the Mount, part 2. My name is Father David Nix, and this is the VLX series Video Lectio Divina. The timestamp for the VLX series, you'll see TS, that means timestamp and theme change. TS is going to mean on the Apple description as well as the YouTube description when we switch from the meditative way of St. Bruno to the meditative way of St. Ignatius of Loyola. That is, at that point, at that switch, maybe you'll see 7:40 on the description. That means at 7 minutes and 40 seconds, we switch to the imaginative way of prayer. That way, some of you who like the way of St. Bruno can know to stop at that point, and those who prefer the imaginative way can see the description on Apple or YouTube and fast forward, scrub all the way to minute 7 seconds 40. Again, thank you so much to all my benefactors, both material and spiritual. I am offering masses and divine office for you. Let us begin in prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God our Lord, we ask the grace that all of our intentions, actions, and operations be directed purely to the service of your divine majesty. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. That is the prayer of St. Ignatius of Loyola. We're still in Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 to 20. Christ says this, "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot, will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Thus are the words of the Holy Gospel. Let's jump into the careful study of St. Bruno. I'd like to look at this verse, "Do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished." I want to show you a few amazing things from Lappy Day here. Again, Lappy Day gets everything from the Church Fathers and the saints. He himself is a saint, I believe. He says this on page 239, quote, "Or rather, till heaven and earth pass means until they wholly perish. The sentence is hypothetical, a conditional or comparative proposition, meaning sooner may heaven be destroyed, sooner the earth be riven in twain, sooner the universe come to an end than the minutest point of the law not be fulfilled, either in this life or in the life to come," end quote. So a comparative proposition would be something like this. Sooner would I eat gas station sushi than vote for Joe Biden. A comparative proposition is something that will never happen. Lappy Day continues, "Christ fulfilled the moral precepts of the law by teaching and validating them more fully and perfectly, and by replacing temporal punishments and rewards with eternal ones, and by adding to the precepts evangelical counsels which are more perfect." So what Lappy Day is saying right there is that the new law is harder and more rewarding to fulfill than the old law. Last thing I want to point out from Lappy Day's on page 244. He says the Pharisees, quote, "fell short of true justice in many things, first because they controlled their external actions more than their internal affections, for they were striving to appear before men as observers of the law and just, second because they perverted the law by a crooked interpretation and explanation, third, because they found their justice more in ceremonies, especially in frequent washings, than in a true spirit of holiness." Christ is teaching the exact opposite here, as is plain in the following verses. "Even the least uneducated Christians must do the exact opposite and so surpass the justice of the scribes if they want to enter heaven," end quote. Many of us were incorrectly taught that the Pharisees were wrong for sticking to the law. Did you catch what Lapide said there? It's actually that they weren't sticking to the law. That's something really huge we have to get in our mind, and I think that's why we misunderstand that line when Jesus says, "Do not think I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." It's Matthew 5:17. Why is that so important? Because the church fathers, echoed here in Lapide, are very clear that the Pharisees executed a crooked interpretation of the Old Testament. So see, it wasn't that Jesus was just this hippie Protestant guy who came to establish the New Testament. Jesus is really clear the Pharisees weren't actually good at the Old Testament. They used subterfuge, they used legalism, and they lost the entire spirit of the law and the letter of the law, which is God's holiness, in the Old Testament there. So again, this is directly from Lapide. The Pharisees had a, quote, crooked interpretation, close quote. Crooked interpretation means they weren't doing the Hebrew way the right way. They weren't doing the Torah the right way. And this is why Christ truly came and fulfilled it and brought us beyond that. And this is why also in verse 20 of today, Jesus says, "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Now remember what I read you last time from Fatima, or rather what Sister Lucy said 30 years after Fatima in 1958. It's pretty striking. She wrote a priest and said, quote, "However, Father, people must be told that they cannot expect any call to prayer and penance from the sovereign pontiff, nor from the bishops, nor from their parish priests, nor from the superiors of religious orders," close quote. And that was 1958. So she just said the hierarchy's not going to call you to the two most important things for salvation nowadays, which is prayer and penance. Starts to sound a lot like what our Lord himself said in the first century around them. "Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." What does this have to do with your meditation? Because you're meditating in 2020, and part of what you bring to prayer has to be where the rubber meets the road of the world that we live in. So, when Jesus lived in a time when you couldn't gauge your holiness by looking at priests around and just saying, "Oh, well, I'm better than them, so I must be on my way to heaven," we're in very similar times. And this is where you have to realize, as you bring this to prayer, God doesn't grade on a curve. "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." He's talking about the religious leaders of his own day. So I'm not telling you this to meditate on that through fear, but rather see this great joy and power in the fact that there's no glass ceiling of holiness and union with God that has to be set by the hierarchy. You don't have to say, "Well, my neighbors think I'm crazy for saying 5 decades of the rosary today, so I'd have to be crazy enough to go to a monastery and leave my family if I did 15 decades a day." No, if you have the time as a businessman or a housewife to pray more, then give God everything you can and stop comparing yourself to your neighbors. Stop comparing yourself to the people who you go to Mass with. So again, I'm not suggesting a meditation on the rigors of God's justice or the flames of hell here, both of which I believe in, by the way. But in that line, "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you'll never enter the kingdom of heaven," I want you to hear that there's so much spiritual freedom to know there is no glass ceiling based on the prayer life of priests or your neighbors or your friends or people you're in a prayer group with, surrounding you is almost some type of like rabbit on the racetrack that you can't surpass. No, you can run as fast as Christ wants you to, giving him your whole heart. But to do that, you have to stop comparing yourself to others, either as being better than them or letting them gauge you into a state of pusillanimity. That's spiritual wimpiness. So you don't want either. You don't want arrogance or pusillanimity, a state of spiritual wimpiness. It's just that there is so much freedom internally when you stop comparing yourself to others in the spiritual life. That's all I want you to see here. We will give you a timestamp here to switch to the method of St. Ignatius of Loyola and St. Teresa of Avila. Today in this method, let's pray for an intimate knowledge of our Lord. Lord, we pray for an intimate knowledge of you. And now, last time we were in that wood shop with Jesus and St. Joseph, I actually want you to stay there today. But last time we did a psalm with him, today you're going to talk to Jesus in the presence of Joseph. Let's review the visual. We are here with a preteen Jesus in this wood shop of Joseph. Maybe it's like a side thing to where Mary is making dinner. I don't know where you want to set it up in your mind, but it's a wood shop right there in their house, filled with light and peace and joy with St. Joseph in there. Now, last time there was a break in all of their work. You took a break with them in their work for them to pray their psalms, and maybe you saw them as I did, so slowly praying that, but not so slow that they were sloppy or mawkish. They prayed as two men with so much power and love of God. Can you see that in your prayer? But in this visual where we use the five senses, I would say in there it smells more of cedar trees than sweat, even though both have been working hard. And as I said last time, perhaps they're dressed like they would be in the movies. Maybe one thing the movies get right, how Jews would have dressed 2,000 years ago. But I want you to imagine the 12-year-old Jesus. Those dark olive eyes kept in such humble containment, same as St. Joseph. And already at 12, he's so strong, but so careful and tender like Joseph. As I said last time, Lapide says of the history of Jesus that, quote, he abstained from pork and strictly observed the other sanctions of the law. By his body, his acts, he fulfilled the ceremonial laws which were figures of the shadows of Christ. He performed and suffered what was prefigured in the ceremonies of the old law, end quote. So this is why we're looking at the law today, to see that Jesus was a very good Jew even as a boy. But as the psalm ends, here's how it's a little bit different from last time. I want you to speak to Jesus as this psalm ends, and I want you to spend 15 minutes, exactly as Father Peter says, quote, the soul begins to talk slowly to Christ, telling him of its love for him, its desire to serve him, its willingness to do anything for him. He adores Christ in the scene of the day's meditation. He expresses his love for him, thanks him for past gifts, petitions him for new favors in the future. So picture this 12-year-old Jesus, and you tell him of your love for him, how in the future you will do anything for him, as you know of his coming crucifixion, and just who he is, the second person of the Trinity. As you meditate on today's meditation in that woodshop, tell him again of that willingness to do anything for him, your love for him, and your desire to serve him his whole life, even this boy who is God. This, we always say God-man. He's the God-boy in this case. Thank him for all those past gifts in your life. Express your love to him as you look at him in this woodshop as you just finished praying, and petition him for new favors in the future. Et benedictio Dei omnipotentis, Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti, descendit super vos et maniat semper. Amen.